Welcome back, everyone, to the Algebraic Graph Theory Seminar. Today we have Willem Hamers, who's going to tell us about the chromatic index of strongly regular graphs. I'll let him take it away. Whenever he is ready.
This is okay?
Yes.
Can you hear me now?
Yep.
Excellent. Okay, can I start?
Yes.
Okay, so the talk is about the chromatic index of strongly regular graph, and it is joint work with Sebastian Chauba and Crystal Guo. And as you can imagine, something strange going on. And I'm going to write this zip code. This I don't understand. Anyhow, there are two parts. And one part is called the chromatic index, and you can guess what the other part is called. And I will give you an introduction about the chromatic index of a graph. Now, here is the definition. For the chromatic index, you color the edges of a graph in such a way that in every vertex, all edges have a different color. So no two edges with the same color meet in a vertex. Now the chromatic index is the minimum number of colors you need to do this. And this example shows you that as an example where the chromatic number index is equal to 4. You see it has been colored with 4 colors, so it should be it should be at least 4, but it cannot be any better, because you cannot do it with fewer colors, because you see one vertex with degree 4 and all these 4 edges need a different color. So you need it at least 4 and at most 4, so 4 is the exact number. Okay, done. For some strange reason, this button don't work anymore. Anyhow, don't confuse it with the chromatic number of a graph. The chromatic number is, for the chromatic numbers, you have to color the vertices in such a way that adjacent vertices always have different colors. So this is a vertex coloring, and the minimum number is called the chromatic number, the minimum number of colors that you need. You can define the chromatic index as the chromatic number of the line graph, if you like. But that's not so relevant for this talk. So there's a famous theorem of Wiesing says that if you have delta, the maximum degree of your graph, then the what you need, of course, you always need delta colors for coloring of the edges. But sometimes you can do it with delta colors. But if you cannot, you can always do it with one more. So only two possibilities for the chromatic index of a graph. That's either the maximum degree or the maximum degree plus one. And the first, if the first case occurs, we call the graph class one. And if the second case occurs, we call the graph class two. That's the definition of the classes which you shall use. So there are only two possibilities. Nevertheless, if you want to determine if the graph is class one, that it is an NP complete problem. So it is hard. Okay, so throughout, I will assume that G is regular and the degree will always be K and the order will always be N. Now here's, think about it. If your graph is regular, of course, the maximum degree is equal to K. And if it is class one, which means that you can color the edges with K colors in every vertex, you need to see all the colors. And if you look at the all edges with the same color, then it is a matching because they may not meet in the vertex, but every vertex sees an edge of each color. So it is, in fact, a perfect matching. So a set of edges with the same color is a perfect matching, also called a one factor. And a partition of the edges into perfect matching is also called a one factorization. So what we're really asking, if you say the class is class one, you might as well say that it has a one factorization, or meaning that it is one factorable. So class one is the same as saying that the graph is one factorable. Now you have some other things. You see, if the graph is class one, then it has a perfect matching. So the order has to be even. So if the order is odd, it is obviously class two. Here's a well-known thing that is in every book on graph theory, I believe, that the complete graph is class one, if and only if n is even. So if your n is even, you can always find a one factorization. Koenig theorems tells you that if you have a bipartite graph, remember that it is regular. So you have a regular bipartite graph, then it's always class one. And this is also a well-known fact that the Petersen graph is not class one. The Petersen graph is class two. So the Petersen graph has degree three. So you need at least four colors. Now, just to get you to as a warm up, I will show you why this is the case. So let me look at the Petersen graph. Here's a picture of the Petersen graph. Maybe you don't immediately recognize it. It gets better if I delete the zeros. So you see the two pentagons sitting there and a matching between the two pentagons. You recognize that? So this is the Petersen graph. Now, I want to color the edges of the Petersen graph. What does it mean? Now, every edge corresponds to two ones in the matrix. And so I have to color ones, yeah, but then in a symmetric way. And so I have to color the ones, but I have to make sure that every vertex sees all the colors, different colors. So in every row and every column, all ones need a different color. And so that's what I have to do. Now, let's get started. So let's look at one color class. That has to be a perfect matching. And so here is a perfect matching, and I color those three. So I can do that, but then I'm left with two pentagons. And for the pentagons, I need at least three colors. So all together, if I do it like this, I need four colors. Now you can argue that I could have started with another perfect matching, but that is not true because all perfect matchings of the Petersen graph are the same, basically. So you always get this picture. So the chromatic index of the Petersen graph is equal to four. Okay. Now let's see some history. There is a famous conjecture of Dirac said that if the graph is rather dense, so the degree is more than half n, then the graph is probably class one. N is even, of course. Now, this has some partial proved. It has been proved asymptotically. So if n is large enough, then it is really true. Now, more results. It is also proved with a different constant than a half here, with this number. If k is greater or equal than that number, then it is true, and is even, then it is class one. So these are known results. Here's another result, which is not as deep, so you don't see any names here. But it is true if the complement of G is bipartite. So we mentioned already that the regular bipartite graph, it is true, but also for the complement. And I want to show you why this is true. So here is the theorem. The complement of a regular bipartite graph, if k is big enough, is class one. So what does it look like? Here is the matrix. You see J is the O1 matrix. So this is a clique, and here is another clique, and there is something that connects the two cliques. Notice that this something is not empty, so this is not disconnected because k is greater than half n, so n is not zero. Now you can always write this as this plus that, and if m is even, then this is class one because of Koenig, and this is class one because the complete graph of even order is class one. So this is easy. Now what if n is odd? if n is odd, you can what you do then is you take inside n, and remember n is not zero. So we can use one perfect matching in n. There is a perfect matching, that's König. So we can use one perfect matching and take it away, and then you get this, and the remainder now has this matching between two complete graphs. And so this is obvious class one, that's König again. And this, now you have to look. And I have to show you that this is class one, I have a little animation. Here you see what you can do. You have to color the ones, yeah, with in this case five colors in a symmetric way. Now what you do is you just move the ones of the matching to the diagonal, and now you color the ones in a cyclic way, very straightforward. You cycle backwards so that the matrix remains symmetric. Yeah, the coloring is symmetric. And now once you have colored it, you remove it back. And so you can always do this. So this proves that the last thing is also class one. So this proves basically the theorem. Okay. So that was the first part. The first part was an introduction about chromatic numbers. So we haven't talked about strongly regular graph yet. Although the examples you saw, the Peterson graph and the other graph were strongly regular graphs. But was not really relevant, but it is just to get used to it. Here, in case you don't know what a strongly regular graph is, here is the definition in picture. Every vertex has k neighbors, two adjacent vertices have lambda common neighbors, and two non-adjacent vertices have mu common neighbors. Now, what is important here is that the complement is again a strongly regular graph, and you can easily compute the parameters. And I also want to distinguish primitive and imprimitive. Now, imprimitive means that the graph is boring, that it is disjoint, that it is disconnected, or the complement is disconnected. I'll come back to that. And otherwise, it is primitive. Now, you've always assume that the eigenvalues are lambda 1 up to lambda n in this order, as you can see. And since we assume that G is regular, the degree is the largest eigenvalue, lambda 1. Now we know if the graph is strongly regular, then there is something going on with the eigenvalues. K is lambda 1, and except for the K, there are only two distinct values for the eigenvalues. And there are easy relations between the parameters and the eigenvalues. So if you know the parameters, you know the eigenvalues, and vice versa. So that is what we know about strongly regular graphs. So why do we look at this at strongly regular graphs for the chromatic index? Yeah? Now, one advantage of strongly regular graphs is that you know a lot about the eigenvalues. So you can use all eigenvalue techniques that you have in your toolbox and hope that some of them will give you some information. And this use of eigenvalue techniques for strongly regular graph for certain constants of certain parameters of graphs work very well for the chromatic number. And I did that a long time ago, but the result was there that if you fix your chromatic number and you look at primitive strongly regular graphs, so only the primitive ones, then there are only finitely many with that chromatic number. And actually, you can work this out, and all strongly regular graphs with chromatic number up to 4 are known. So just a short list if you look at the primitive ones. So I think it's about 20 primitive strongly regular graphs that have chromatic number at most 4. So that worked well, and it uses strongly uses eigenvalue techniques there in this result. And a little bit later, Alex Rozak, when I met him, he asked me, can you do something like that with the chromatic index of strongly regular graph? So he was actually the one who first addressed this problem and hoped that I could do something with the eigenvalue methods. And that was in my mind for a very long time. And I couldn't find much. And at some point, Sebastian took up the problem, and he and Crystal start working on it. And we did get at least some results. Now, first of all, I want to consider the imprimative case. Now, imprimative is kind of easy. Either the graph is disconnected, and then it's a disjoint union of complete graphs, all of the same size. And in this case, the size is L. So M complete graphs of size L, and that is Clasland precisely when L is even, which is obvious because they have a number of clicks, and each of these clicks should be colored with L colors. So when L is even, the disjoint union is class one. Now, what about the complement? The complement is a complete multi-partite graph, and it is known, and people have worked it out, and this is class one precisely when N is even. So the imprimative case is done. Now, what else can we say? Now, Andries Bauer and I had looked at perfect matching in relations to eigenvalues. And we could prove that if N is even, then there is a certain number of adjoint perfect matching in the graph. And the number is given there, and it's just it's roughly half the spectral depth. So the difference between the largest eigenvalue, the degree, and the second largest eigenvalue divided by two, and the 1 year and the rounding, but roughly that's the idea. So it's it's not a small number, but it's far from K, with that's what we want for an edge coloring with K colors. So, but this tells you that they're all, that if that you have many perfect matching if D lambda 2 is far from K. And for every strongly regular graph, lambda 2 is far enough from K to have that this number is always greater or equal to 1. And so every strongly regular graph must have a perfect matching if N is even. Yeah? So it follows from that, and most of them have many perfect matching, so that also follows. I think it's only the Peterson graph that only has one perfect matching, so this is, and then if you delete it, then there is nothing left. I want to talk about another result, about the chromatic number this time. You see, it's chi, not chi prime, in this form. There's a famous theorem of Alan Hoffman that tells you that the chromatic number is bounded from below by 1 minus lambda 1 over lambda n. Now, we are talking about regular graphs, so if the graph is regular, it says 1 minus k over lambda n is a lower bound for the chromatic number. Now, in the case that the graph is regular, then you have a strong condition in case of equality. If the graph is regular and you have equality for this chromatic number bound, it means that all color classes must have the same size. They have the same number of vertices. That's one thing. And then another thing, that is that the partition and color classes are equitable, but you can even be more precise. You can say that for every color class, every vertex outside that color class has exactly minus lambda n neighbors in that color class. So apparently minus lambda n is a positive integer. And this is what holds for such a coloring of a regular graph. It is far from true if the graph is not regular, by the way. The Hoffman bounds is if tied for every bipartite graph, but there's no reason why this equality property holds for every bipartite graph, of course. Now, from this, we can prove, we find a sufficient condition for a graph to be class one, for a regular graph to be class one, actually. And if this graph is regular, and this bound of Hoffman is tight, and if the chromatic number is even, then the graph is class one. And it is also true for the complement. So both the graph and its complement is class one if you have this. There's one exception, which is obvious, then the graph, if the graph is a complete multipartite graph, then the complement is disconnected, this is a disjoint union of cliques, and then the cliques can all have odd size and it doesn't work. But that's not so relevant, but it is an exception. Now I want to show you the proof. So let's look at it. Here's an example. I prove by example. The proof is by example, and in the example, the chromatic number is equal to 4. Now here's the matrix. So the chromatic number is equal to 4. So I put the 4 color classes together in the matrix. So you see 4 blocks with all zeros here, which correspond to the vertices of the same color. So you have this color class. And between these are matrices, I call them N. And what I do know is that this partition is equitable. It means that every Nij has a constant row and column sum equal to minus lambda n. Yeah, now the value is not so important, but it has to be equitable. That's what you have to remember. Now, what you do is the following. You partition the edges in this way such that in each part, you see a disjoint union of bipartite graphs. You see? So here is here you see 2 bipartite graphs, here you see 2 bipartite graphs, and here you see 2 bipartite graphs, and that's it. Can you always do so? Can you always have, if you have a matrix like that, can you always do this partition? Now, what it is this structure here is a complete graph of size 4 that gives you the structure of the ends, yeah, the quotient, if you like. And what you have to do is you have to find, this corresponds to a perfect matching, and this corresponds to a perfect matching, and this corresponds to a perfect matching in the quotient graph. So what you need here is, in fact, one factorization of the complete graph. And if the order is even, you can do that. So because there is a one factorization of the complete graph of even order, if the number of colors is even, you can always find a partition like this. And then, now you look at it, and this is here you see two graphs, 2 bipartite graphs, and we know now that Nij is regular. So the regular bipartite graphs, and though they are class one, both parts are class one, and the same is true here, and the same is true there. So all these parts are class one, and so it tells you that this graph has to be class one. So what about the complement? Now in the complement, you have the cliques on the diagonal, and these are now complements, but it doesn't matter because I only use that they have constant row in the column sum. So you can assume that you have this structure. And now you get the same kind of partition, only in one of these matrices, I put J minus I on the diagonal, and the other one remains 0 on the diagonal. Now this is class one, this was class one and is still class one. But here you have J minus I on the diagonal, but now you have the complement of a bipartite regular graph, and we have seen earlier that this is also class one. So that's the end of the proof. Now, what does it mean for strongly regular graph? Now, there's a famous class of strongly regular graph, the Latin square graph. And if a Latin square graph has even order, then it follows from the previous that has to be class one. Let me remind you what a class Latin square graph is. If you have a set of mutual orthogonal Latin squares, yeah, so you may have more than one square, so a set of orthogonal Latin squares, and you define a graph, the vertices are the entries of the square, and 2 vertices are adjacent if they are the same row, the same column, or they have the same symbol in one of the squares. that is a well-known, famous, strongly regular graph. Now, if you look at such a Latin square graph, then one row is always a clique. So the rows give you a partition into cliques. And the complement, this means that you have a partitioning into independent sets, or if you like, in color classes. And you have a coloring of that graph, and it is just easy to work out that this is indeed a coloring that satisfies the conditions. And so we can assume that the Latin square graph and its complement is class one when the order is even. So we have one big family of strongly regular graphs for which we know that they are class one. We have some more sufficient condition for being class one, but we see what about the known cases? Can we check by computer and see if what is going on? Now that's what we did, and there is a nice thing that we looked at strongly regular graphs, more strongly regular graphs, and it so happens that if you look at the list of Andries Brouwer, the all strongly regular graphs that have degree at most 18 are known. And here is the list. And so this is the list that we took from Andries' table. And so these are, of course, only the primitive ones. N even. For N is odd, this is not, there are several cases when K is smaller than less or equal to 18 and N is odd where there is no complete list, but for N is even it is. We took the ones with K less than or equal to half N, otherwise you take the complement. And actually the first column, the complement also has K less than or equal to 18. So there are a few more than just these we see here. So some of these are quite famous. Here is Hoffman-Singleton and here is Gewirtz. Some of them we've seen already. Here is one from, it is a Latin square, but then a Latin square without symbols, it means a lattice graph. You only have rows and columns. So these are known to be unique anyhow. So this is the lattice graph, if you like. And so some of them are well known and some of them, some of them may be not very familiar to you, but in any case, for all these graphs, a complete enumeration has been done, and also there is exactly known how many there are. Now, this one is obviously the Peterson graph, and the Peterson graph is class two, as we have seen. Now, it turns out by computer that all the other ones are class one. I'll say a little bit more about this computer. So most of these graphs are given by the homepage of Ted Spence. He has a list of strongly regular graphs, and you can download them and then check. And so we did, and we found one factorization in each of these graphs, except of course the Peterson graph. So we have a theorem. We have a theorem that says that except for the Peterson graph, a primitive strongly regular graph of even order and degree at most 18 is class one. And the same is true for the complement. The complement of the Peterson graph is class one, in case that is not clear. I thought it was a nice idea to show you a page of this this list of Andries Brouwer. People, I occasionally take a look at it, and I looked at it maybe a month, 2 or 3 months ago, and to my surprise, of course, let me first say that this 167 here on 64 is something you saw in the table two slides ago. So this is some of the things here that we've seen are in this list. But what I was very surprised at that moment is to see that this one, the 6532, is green. And that you saw it by coincidence. So this was for a long time, I think for maybe 30 or 40 years, the smallest open case for the existence of astronomy regular graph. And all of a sudden it was filled in. So I mailed Andries and he sent me the graph, so there is no doubt about it. And I saw that now this paper of Gritsenko is available. So it's on the archive. So but it pays off to look occasionally at the list of Andries, and you can see sometimes surprising changes. Okay, that is the computer work. There is also an asymptotic result. And therefore we use a theorem of Ferber and James. And that is a theorem in terms of the eigenvalues. So you talk again about a regular graph of the degree k, and it basically says that if k is big enough and if n is big enough, and if k is the by far the largest eigenvalue, it is much larger than the, let's say, absolute values of the other eigenvalue, then you can conclude, did I say that n is even? Anyhow, if n is even, then you can conclude that the chromatic index is equal to k, so that it is class one. So the precise statement is here, you can better read it yourself, I cannot do it any better. So what can we do with that? Now we know something about the eigenvalues of strongly regular graphs, and so maybe this works if we look at strongly regular graph. And as a matter of fact, we can draw a conclusion. The conclusion is that for a strongly regular graph, there is an integer such that is n is greater than that integer, then the graph is not the block graph of a Steiner to design or its complement, then it is class one. So more or less it said that all strongly regular graphs that are big enough and have even order are class one, with one exception, the Steiner two designs, the block graph of those and the complement. And I will show you how this corollary follows from the theorem of Ferber and Jain. So here are a sketch of the proof. First of all, of course, the diameter of a strongly regular graph is 2. And so that means that n is bounded by k squared plus 1. And that means that if you want to apply Ferber and Jain, we don't need a condition on k. If n is big enough, then automatically k is big enough. In other words, yeah, you can always make sure that k is big enough by taking n big enough. So there is only one condition there. And then there is a result of Neumeier, an old result of Neumeier. And that says if G is not a Lattice square graph or the block graph of a Steiner design, so there are two exceptions in Neumeier theorem, then they have an inequality in the eigenvalues like this. This is a conclusion. It is basically known as the claw bound combined with the mu bound, and these are both things in Neumeier's paper. And if you combine them, you then you can find this. So you have a bound. You can bound lambda two in terms of lambda n like this. And you can also do with the complement. Now, more or less, the complement lambda n and lambda 2 interchange, roughly. And so you can do something similar with the complement. And then if you apply that to the complement and you do a little bit of computation, you see that you find that the maximum of these two values, yeah, is bounded by k to some power, and what is important, of course, is that this number is smaller than one. And this is exactly what you need to apply Ferber and Jain. So this has to be k to some power smaller than one. That was what it needed there. So we can draw this crude conclusion, but of course we use that G is not the block half of a Steiner system or a Latin square graph, and you also used it for the complement of G. So these two things are accepted here. But we know already that the Latin square graph are not a problem. We have proved that they are class one. So the only case that is left is the Steiner graph of a block graph of a Steiner system and the complement. Let me remind you what it is, the block graph of a Steiner system. So you have such a Steiner design, and the graph is defined on the blocks, and two blocks are adjacent and they intersect. And you get a strongly regular graph with these parameters. And they can be primitive, but if this holds, then it is a primitive, strongly regular graph. And if M is equal to 2, then your blocks are just pairs. And then a Steiner system, to be a Steiner system, you have to take all the pairs. And that means that you have to look at the triangular graph, which is a famous strongly regular graph. But the order of the triangular graph is even whenever V is 0, 1, mod 4. So we have to look at that. Now, for a long time, we, that means semi-crystal and me, have been trying to prove that it is class 1. And we had half a proof or something like that. But after, after a couple of years, actually, we found a paper of Alsbach that proves it, and that tells you that the triangular graph is class one if the order is even. Now, what is maybe interesting is that we can do the complement of the triangular graph. It is also class one and even. And the proof is very simple. We did it by computer for V up to 21. So that means that the number, the order is 21 choose 2, is 210. So we did it by computer for all these cases. And then for the other case, I mentioned the result of Cariolaro and Hilton, that it is true if K is greater or equal to 0.8 times V, if you remember well. And you can apply it here. And for V greater or equal to 25, Cariolaro and Hilton applies. And of course, 22 and 23 don't work because then the order is odd. So this completes it. So the complement is in a way easier. So what we conjecture now is that the Petersen graph is the only exception. And so except for the Petersen graph, every connected strongly regular graph of even order is class one. Connected is there, could also say primitive, but connected is better because the imprimitive one, which is not connected, is there for that. These graphs, the conjecture also holds. So this is the stronger statement. So this is what we have, and we could try what kind of. So we haven't the complete result. We haven't, but there are still some open cases. For instance, to prove the conjecture. Or the other thing is what you also could do is to prove the conjecture asymptotically. Now that means that you only have to look at the block graphs of Steiner system with the complement, because for all other strongly regular graphs, this asymptotic result is true. We just started for the triangular graph. The complement of the triangular graph is in a way easier. That means that you could use Cariolaro and Hilton. So you only need to do it for smaller cases. The problem is, it's not automatically true that you can say that for the complement it's asymptotically true. If you fix the block size, then you can say that that if n is big enough, the graph is class two if the order is even. But if you don't fix the block size, then you cannot say that. Not yet, anyhow. Okay, that is if you believe the conjecture. If you don't believe the conjecture, then you can try to disprove it, of course. And so what you could do is try to find another strongly regular graph of even order, a different one from the Peterson graph, which is class two. That will be very interesting. And a little bit weaker, but not much weaker, is the following that you could, what I really would like to have is two strongly regular graphs with the same spectrum, that means with the same parameters. So the same parameters, where one is class one and the other one is class two. And that would, of course, disprove the conjecture, and it would be also very interesting for me, because I'm interested in properties that can be deduced from the spectrum, and that will be a counterexample to the question if being class one or class zero is determined by the spectrum. Okay. That's it. Thank you. Oh, here, I have French-speaking Canadians.
Thank you. Do we have questions?
Willem, when you assumed that the chromatic number was nice and you had your equitable partition, I was wondering if there's a more straightforward way to get your edge coloring. Could you put that slide up where you had the N12, N13s, and so on? Maybe I'm missing something.
This one.
Yeah, so N12 has constant row and column sum. So Koenig's theorem tells me that I can find permutation matrices that sum to N12. Is that correct?
Permutation matrices that
summing to N12.
Yeah.
And then transpose that and get an edge coloring of that block. Can I just repeat that?
Yeah, but I think that's basically what I'm doing.
Yeah. Oh. Okay. I was just wondering why you had to pair them up. Why did you have to pair up? And 3-4. I see. You need to. Yeah. So you need. You wanted to make sure the same color. You want to identify those colors ahead of time. Okay. Now I understand. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Maybe I can ask a question. Willem, some measurement for pseudorandomness, for strongly regular graphs is that, one way I view it sometimes is the least pseudorandom strongly regular graphs are the ones where you have equality in Krein parameters, and the most ones are where the lambda and mu are the same vaguely. Are there any special graphs? I was thinking of generalized quadrangles of order SS², where you have equality in Krein parameters, where your pseudorandomness argument is the worst in some sense, where you can still show that your conjecture is true. Like, I guess triangular graphs are an example for that.
I don't know precisely what. So you have strongly, you look at strongly regular graphs that are extreme, or what do you mean?
Pseudorandom means that the second largest eigenvalue in absolute value is as far away from the largest
eigenvalue as possible. Okay.
And so the Krein parameters are the worst case of pseudorandomness in some sense.
I see, that's what you mean. Okay, I didn't get it precisely. Yeah, okay.
Like it's a counter example, I would think it's maybe more there than.
Yeah, it helps in finding disjoint perfect matching because of the bound that Andries and I found. So it tells you that you have a lot of disjoint perfect matchings, but it doesn't tell you that you can get far enough. So you would expect that it is easier for those. But actually, it is very easy, always very easy. For some reason, it's easy to find a one factorization if there is one. even if the problem is NP-hard, it is, in practice, you always find one if there is one.
Okay, so it's like cross-spectral graphs. When there's a cross-spectral graph, you always find more. Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Yeah, I'll follow up on that comment you just made about always finding the one factorization when they're there. How do you mean that? Like, do you mean you can just look at the graph and find it? Or do you mean the algorithm finds it quickly, or?
Yeah, that's what I mean. So the algorithm that we used is very straightforward. You just look for perfect matching and you throw it away, and then in the remainder you look again for a perfect matching. And there is this very straightforward algorithm worked very easy. Gotcha. Maybe the one or two times that you have to backtrack, but basically not. So there is not much computer time used in this research. It's a bit strange because it is an NP-hard problem to determine it, but